the Drawback the Movie, you'll be subjected to interviews, live performances, and even some crazy and humorous banter. First off, let's talk to Tim Chair, a band confidant, friend, and former rocker himself.
I mean, Drawback has showed me a lot about life, about the male anatomy. I mean, they have phallic members that are just like golden eggs that a goose lays, and they're beautiful. But they taught me a lot, you know, about they just taught me a lot about sexuality, life. I mean, they play okay music too, but I love them for, you know, so much more than that. Matt is like a squirrel. He loves his nuts, but is quite small. Zach is just a crazy phenom that, you know, he has heart, he has longevity, he has stamina, and
he's like the beaver. He likes Travis, to gnaw wood.
Travis is like the clumsy but strapping young horse, the young buck that is, overflowing with ambition, but, you know, he's just held down by his bass guitar. I mean, that's just what I think, though.
Thanks for friends every time we hang out.
Like, Tim's a fucking gay faggot.
Like, oh, man, we gotta hang out with that guy. He's like fucking ugly and shit.
Hey,
man,
Tim.
We don't hang out with ugly people.
He calls me 3 times a day, and I have to, hey, Tim, every day. Like, oh, well, actually, I gotta go right now.
I'm beating it.
You're seeing this, Tim? Fuck off.
He's a misogynist, a bigot, and a racist.
He's a misogynist?
Don't hold back, dude. Let it all out. Come on, don't hold back.
And he's ugly. He's ashamed of his own body.
That's true.
Because he shaves himself. It's disgusting. Can't play guitar. He wears baggy pants.
Knows how to break dance.
I haven't seen him break dance. I heard he's been involved with rock music, which is never safe.
And the Cobra Kai.
Yeah.
And the cell.
Hello there. My name's Matthew Dangerstairs III. I play drums in the band Drawback. Seen here.
I am Zach. I play guitar and I sing in Drawback.
If there's one thing I learned about Drawback is that everything Zach says is wrong. That's it.
Now we're in SoCal. It was nice weather. It's fucking nice weather. We're about to pass out with some dudes.
Yeah.
Gonna curl up and gonna loot some spoon. Go pass out with the dudes.
Thank you, Travis.
Me, Bradley. We're
getting together. We're going together.
We're gonna stay together, man.
My name's Travis. Play bass and sing in the band called Drawback.
You want to hear a totally shitty story? So this caps off Drawback's career. We're on our way to the fucking menu tonight, and Zach over here, oh, we got plenty of gas.
Plenty of gas.
We're fucking totally good to get there to the venue. We get over the Ross Island Bridge. We're about to turn right onto 4th, come up a little hill there. Zach's like, oh, fuck.
We ran out of gas.
So all of us but Zach, because Zach's driving.
I had to steer the vehicle, Travis.
Yeah, we pushed a fucking 16-passenger van full of shit up a hill until we got gravity took over and got us to the 76th at Appalachian State Forest.
Shut the fuck up!
Hey, it sounds like our drummer. You want to come fucking play or what?
You fucking suck!
Hey, cute beard guy.
Who is Zach? He's in the band? Yeah. Oh, okay. Oh, the guy who plays guitar in Drawback. First time I met him, he called me up randomly, and he's like, I was like, I think I was 21 and like crying at my mom's house being sad because I had no job and my other band broke up. And he's like, our band Andy, A New Day Yesterday, needs a drummer. Do you want to just like hang out with us and play? Come to our garage. And I came over, and it was like him and his friends, Michael Palachek and Derek, and Zach, and they were like giving each other tattoos, like homemade tattoos in the house, and smoking tons of pot and talking about how they wanted to be on Warped Tour by next year. And I was like, all right, Zach seems like a nice guy. And I was playing in their band for a little bit, and we did like a high school talent show, which was weird at my high school to be back there years later. And then after that, I was doing Ninjas with Syringes by myself. I recorded like a 12-14 song CD in my friend Kyle's basement. It was just like a 16-year-old kid I knew who had a computer. And I was like 21, so I was like, we'd always joke, like, why the fuck am I over here doing this?
Matt is a guy I've known almost since high school. I think we met our first, or it was my first year out of high school at Mount Hood Community College.
Actually, I met him because he's wearing a Saves the Day shirt. We were in, like, computer something or other 101, and I saw the dude, like, every other day when we had the computer class. It was like a giant stadium classroom, and I was like, there's that dude, it's a Saves the Day shirt. He wears it every day. Or he'd always wear cool band shirts, and I was like, I should probably be friends with that guy.
I think he was out. He's a year older than me. And our bands at the time were playing together quite often, and both our bands broke up.
I was like, here, listen to this stuff I did for my solo project. And he gave me one of his demos, and I listened to it, and I was like, all the songs were 5 to 8 minutes long. And I was like, this is really good music, I think, and I hear like all this potential in it. And
we're like, hey, let's form a band.
I was like, but we should probably cut down your songs, like, if we're going to like do them. We started playing songs like Run Home Jack and Black Stars, and or we call it Black Stars. Anyway, some songs off our first demo. So Travis and I got in there and started busting demos. We did like 3 songs, and they're terrible, but at the time we're like, fuck yeah, this is awesome. We recorded Teddy and like some other song, I think maybe Unjust Use of Society or something like that. And then we're like, fuck, let's start a band, because Travis and I started hanging out. We're like, yeah, this will be fucking great. We'll start a band, but we need a guitar player. And at the time, we were like, who do we know who plays guitar? And I was like, I don't know anyone. I could try Ryan from my last band. I was like, there's this Zach kid. I don't know, he seems kind of weird. He's in this indie band.
When I first met Zach, Matt and I started playing together, and he's like, I know this guy. Awesome punk rock dude. He'll show up. He'll blow your mind on guitar. And here comes this guy showing, rolling up in a dirty 80s Camaro, pops out with his mess t-shirt and the palest skin I've ever seen, but with a heart of gold.
We actually auditioned another guy. Zach wasn't our first choice. There's another guy that Travis is friends with, who, like, he was in, like, some psychology class with Travis at Mount Hood Community College where we met or something. He's like, I play guitar a little bit, you know, mostly Creed, kind of some heavier stuff, maybe some, like, Nickelback or whatever. And then we, like, waited for him to show up, and he never showed up for his audition. So I was like, I'll call Zach. And then Zach came over, and he's like, hey, guys! And he's really clean cut, and we all agreed he looked like Corey from Boy Meets World, so he was pretty much in after that. And he did anything we said at first.
He will blow your mind with such quotes as, there's black widow spiders in every house in Oregon, and he apparently thinks the San Francisco Bay is the same thing as the ocean because it's the same type of water. All good things. If you ever get to meet Zach, please ask him these. It'll be good.
What do I say about Travis? Well, it's hard to talk with him half the time, because half the time there's food in his mouth. But half the time, you know, he's trying to sleep with high school girls. So there's like at least a ninth of the time where we get a chat, and it's usually about high school girls or eating. So I don't know what to say.
Even though Drawback's extremely busy schedule gives him little time for leisure, we thankfully have gotten Drawback here for a wonderful interview, and it's truly great to have them here and experience all the magic. Well, thank you guys for meeting with me on a somewhat short notice. Name some of the bands that have influenced you guys.
Any band with a lead singing bass player. I mean, Mill and Colin.
MXPX.
Blink-182.
The Blink-182.
I mean, they are why we're a band. I mean, that's just simply because they have a lead singing bass player.
That's simply
sexy.
That's it.
Now, we were big fans of Lawrence Arms, Alkaline Trio, Love Trio. Good power rock band. Fucking yeah.
Mill and Colin, Face to Face.
You said Mill and Colin, yeah.
No, I said it.
Oh, okay.
Boxcar Racer is good. I don't know.
All the Epitaph bands. Pennywise, big staple when I was a kid.
No
Rancid.
Use. No Use, Leg Wagon. Did you say that?
I already said
God damn, fuck.
Did you?
Strung out. Low strung out.
Strike anywhere.
Strike anywhere. It's like the only hoodie I have left that I wear on a daily basis.
I had this Bouncing Souls hoodie once.
Bouncing
this
Souls.
Fucking douchebag took my hoodie.
I think he's wearing it. Bouncing Souls. We
it's
love
funny, you're wearing
souls.
My shoes, by the way.
Goodyear, Wheelchair Renegade.
Well, I thought we were talking about bands.
Randall 58. My Life in Black and White.
All great bands.
Not bands that inspire us, that's the bands that we played with. Remember?
Those bands inspire me. God damn it.
Okay, sorry.
My Life in Black and White has an album called Bottles Are Breakdowns. You guys have a song called Breakdowns Are Bottles. What gives?
Funny story about that, too. We couldn't think of a name, so and we were just fucking around. We're like, because for a while, whenever we write a song, we never write the name until, like, it's literally time to record it. Yeah. It always has, like, some stupid name. Like, I can't even remember someone back in the day.
Yeah, we used to call, like, Addison used to be called, like, Robococculus.
Oh, yeah, and then, Take What You Want was Buck and a Buffalo.
Yeah, we had all these stupid names that we probably should have kept, but then at the last minute...
Yeah, Bottles Are Breakdowns was one of those. Breakdowns Are Bottles, whatever.
We're all friends with My Life in Black and White. And, and I was like, what if we, like, flipped it around or whatever, like, bottle. You know, because theirs is called Bottles Are...
Breakdowns. Yeah, Bottles and Breakdowns, and we did Breakdowns and Bottles. So we just basically, that was the pretend name until we got in the studio. We never came up with anything better, so we just left it. And then I remember we never told them about that. And I went to a My Life show, and it was like right after we recorded, and then we posted it on the MySpace probably a couple months later, and I completely forgot. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, I was watching My Life at the Astry, and we're hanging out upstairs, and out of nowhere, Ben looks at me and goes, did you guys really fucking name your song Breakdowns Are Bottles? And I started laughing. I was like, yeah, I did. We did. What are you going to do?
I mean, ha.
Well, it's because we're...
because of copyright infringement, we had a
friend. Yeah, we're friends with them.
We like to steal.
So what's the song even about?
I wrote the song as, like, the comparisons between trying to break up with a girlfriend and trying to quit drinking. Because both of them love you. But both of them treat you like shit, too. You know, I mean, you have some awesome sex with a chick. The night is fun. You're great. You wake up the next morning, she's yelling at you. You're like, ah, same thing. You drink all night with your beer. You're like, beer, you're so good. I love you, beer. You wake up the next morning, you're hungover.
I
want to
put my dick in you, beer.
What the fuck is that about? Like, so I don't know. I just thought it was kind of funny, the comparison between, because I've tried to quit drinking, and it doesn't work. I'm not even an alcoholic. I was like, let's just see if I can go a month and... It's the casual beer, like when somebody walks in like, hey, Travis, you're good looking. I want to buy you a beer. You know, I can't turn that down.
I love that song. Good song. Best song.
It's only ever. Three chords, kids. That shows you what you can do with three chords. You don't have to be a real musician to make a song.
It's got some reggae fucking beats in it, and it's hot.
We're not very creative. We like D and A and
when
G.
When we recorded it with Dave Lindell, he would mix around all the lyrics, so they were very funny. And, ask him about it.
Yeah, I'll ask him about that sometime.
I don't remember.
Yeah.
Oh, he always used to the whiskey pumping through my heart and through my veins. He come
in and he's like, I see a guy in a giant styrofoam heart costume when you guys play live. Can come out, whiskey can pour out into the mouths of the children. And just be like, oh, or something like that. And then he's like, I put out an S.O.S.
I got a dick in again.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't find it very funny.
It's funny as shit, man.
You had to be there, really.
No, it's I put out an ass.
That's what it is.
That's why it's funny, because you gotta dick that ass again.
That was the joke.
That's a riot. Here's Drawback's Breakdowns Are Bottles.
Thank you.
Who is this, Dave? Who are we listening to?
A band called Verse.
That's not a name I'd choose for a band, because you can get a lot of lame jokes coming out of that.
Yeah, just like, sweet verse.
We're, up next is chorus, followed by bridge, and chorus will play again after bridge.
You know, Travis, some of us don't base our life around petty put-downs and childish jokes.
I do. How do you think I get the 18-year-old? Hey-o!
Oh, shit.
Fuck, I should feel bad.
Get your dicks up. Oh, we have one more.
Why is that happening?
Why is that allowed?
I don't know. Pat's fucking in a leather outfit, dude.
Principal
look at that.
Butcher, you're my grade school.
Hold on. Do we love America?
What's the song How to Swim about?
Well, oddly enough, I'd like to say a lot of it had to do like a tie-ins in and out to the relationship I was in, because it was a rocky one for the last couple of years. Which, and we did end up breaking up within a year after me writing that song, I think. Yeah, it was about a year after I wrote that song, so. I mean, a lot of it was what I was going through in that relationship, but then more or less it was kind of the same thing, like what it would be like if I had gotten dumped, or if a relationship I'd been in a long time, or for a long time, had just ended that day.
So you're saying it's not even a real story?
It sounds kind of cheesy. Probably not what you wanted to hear, but.
Well, I really feel like I can't trust you anymore, Travis, knowing that your lyrical content is comprised of mainly lies. Here's Drawback playing How to Swim, which is a pure fabrication and only exists in Travis's imagination. And I think we all feel horrible about that.
Travis, Zach, Travis, and Matt. Travis at
all good guys, beautiful guys.
Great guys.
Great guys, good man. Great guys, good man.
What are their names again?
Matt and Travis. Zach, Matt and Travis. These guys, yeah. Awesome. You guys rock. Come on. Yeah. I don't think any of them are talented. The only thing I just think they play punk rock. And they're all really good at what they do.
They sing loud and they sing fucking proud.
Yeah.
Heck yeah. Keep that one on the board.
2009.
2009. Drawback. Matt, Zach, and Travis.
No, Zach Travis and Matt.
Oh, Zach Travis and Matt. I'm sorry.
Cheers, Drawback. Cheers.
Travis, Zach, and Matt.
Zach Travis and Matt.
In 1987, Drawback went on tour with the Wheelchair Renegades and Rental 58. Here is what that experience was like.
So wicked, what are we dipping? It's cool and unforgiven.
Unforbidden.
Unforgiven. Don't let off.
I think it was like the first tour we went on, and it was super fun, and we're with our best friends, like, at the time, Wheelchair Renegades and Rental 58, and it's three bands from Portland and Corvallis. Like, we're the Portland band, the other two bands were from Corvallis, and we're like, let's do a tour together.
Oh, we went on tour with Wheelchair Renegades and Rental 58. It's the first tour we did as a band in 2005, all the way down to San Diego and back.
We're pretty fucking stoked about a lot of things because we're like, yeah, we're a band, we're the shit, we're on the road now. But I mean, really, we didn't have much to show for it at the end, but good times, which is what's important.
When we left, Matt and I were the only ones above the age of 21, so drinking was a tougher road. About 11 dudes stuffed in two cars, my Ford Explorer and another like minivan pulling trailers.
By the time we got to San Diego, we played like a sports bar, and during the day, we just like hung out on the beach and I don't know, drank margaritas and like danced around or something. I don't really remember too much of it. It was fun. It was beautiful San Diego beach, and it was snowing in Portland. I remember we're calling our friends, and they were like, "Oh, it's snowing here," and we're like, "Fuck, it's like 70 degrees here," because it was winter time. It was like our first tour. We went during the winter, and yeah, it was fucked up. It was in San Diego. It was a hoot. We just like walked up and down the beach and just like slapped people's asses and I don't know, got ice cream.
Points. The Pelican Taylor.
Come on.
What the fuck broke that off? Just an apple leg.
Wow.
When
I was raving on, I saw you big on the wow.
Don't get ads like that from playing bass guitar. Dude, that was natural. Yes, I've had many compliments on my robust chest hair. It grows out billowy like a winter oak in full bloom.
Run home, Jack!
He's running away into the sunset, guys. It's over.
I bet you the water's really warm too. Look at it. Cool.
Storm is chasing his lover.
I bet you the water's freaking warm as hell.
No?
No.
Look at the shine on here, look at the shine. Bam, bam, bam,
bam, bam.
Society lost, it's all right tonight. It won't be long before we go.
$5.
Yeah.
Appreciate my
you suck at drumming.
My talent with everything.
You suck at drumming.
You suck at drumming.
I think we're in Sacramento. We're bored. No, we were in Chico. Manteca, maybe, or something.
We just stopped at the music shop because, you know, you've got like, you know, 8 hours in a day where you do absolutely nothing. So you're like, let's go to the music shop because we're musicians, right? That's what normal people do. We go there, we're just hanging out, having a good time. I mean, some people playing drums. I think there's an electronic drum battle beat off. I don't remember who won, but
it was like an electronic drum set, and Adam Brown and I and Dave Schwarm, everyone decided we should have like a drum off, so we took turns fucking around, like doing the best we could on like this electronic drum set. And it was a lot of fun. I think it drew like a crowd of us and the guy who was working for commission. And it was fun. It's on videotape. And watch it now.
I know, man. You're on a roll.
Thank you.
That. So we got some pot brownies. So we're playing in. We played a show in Provo, Utah, and then we had to drive to Salt Lake City the next day.
Compliments to Mike Schuster.
Not Salt Lake City.
Oh yeah.
We're driving to Provo. We had to drive to Reno, which is like 9 hours in our 50-mile-an-hour no air conditioning van across the Nevada desert.
No air conditioning.
So we wake up pretty early. We're like, we'll hit the road around like what, 8 or 9.
So, we had some breakfast burritos.
Yeah, we get up. We had some breakfast burritos at the hotel, and we're pulling out of the hotel. We're like, "Fuck, we got those pot brownies. Let's party." I mean, Matt and I weren't driving, so
day two, I met him gone wild. Yeah,
I think I was driving.
This was the second day of this tour, and I had never had pot brownies before. Matt hadn't, and we didn't realize that if you eat more than one, your party goes up exponentially. So.
The fun is exponentially, right?
Each brownie is not double.
No.
Apparently, it takes a few, like, 3 hours for it to, like, hit your system when you digest wheat in your stomach.
Together, we killed 8 pot brownies in a span of, like, 15 minutes.
Yeah, we're just hungry.
It was, like, 15 minutes we were hungry, so we ate, like, 8 of them. And then he decides...
Whenever that Pulley song comes on, Drink Like There's No Tomorrow, you have to drink like there's no tomorrow. And then blast the song, yell at your friends.
There was a party in the van.
So
at that point, while we were driving,
Matt was taking pulls off of JD that had been in the 100-degree heat the whole day.
Like, spitting at people and yelling at yelling at Zach. And I was like, Zach, you did such a good job driving.
Oh, no. So we partied pretty hard for, like, a good solid couple hours. And then all of a sudden, I'm like, hit the wall. I'm feeling like shit, and I'm laying down. And I'm like, man, I feel like death. I want to die. And then all of a sudden, I hear Matt go, hey guys, can you pull over the next stop? Man, I don't feel so good. And I rolled over. I'm like, fuck, that guy looks way worse than me.
No, hold on before you get to the good stuff. I'm going to tell you some of the backstory. In my head, the explosion was playing. And it's like one of their songs. And like, this is filthy. This is fucking insane. And I was like, in my head, they were just like, on my brain. I was like, I'm going to fucking die and shit. And in my head, I thought like the van was going up. Like, in a space, and I was just like, guys! Like, in my head.
So, Matt decided, he tells them they need to pull over the next rest stop. Well, not more than, like, 2 minutes later, doesn't make it to the rest stop, and,
he's vomiting.
He's like, oh, and throws up all over one of our roadies, bonus Matt.
Did you throw money?
Yeah,
Our
friend, bonus Matt, our dear friend.
He
caught vomit all over the leg. So we had to pull over. So Matt starts puking, I get out, and it's like 100 degrees, we're out right along the salt flats, and I'm looking at Matt puke, and I'm like, oh, I want to puke right now.
No, and so I'm there, and I'm like, Travis, you okay?
I'll be okay.
And then he walks away, 2 seconds later, so in the front of the van. Remember earlier, the breakfast burritos we had, it's just egg, like, yes, yellow vomit, just blah, 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 brownie, blah, blah, JD, blah, blah. I remember when I was laying in the van, my girlfriend was calling me, I was like, I can't move, and I was like, ignore that call, because I was like, I'm going to die in this van right now, and I need to be there for it.
The best statement of the day, Matt's bent over like this after vomiting for like 20 straight minutes with death in his eyes, and bonus Matt looks at him and goes, hey, isn't this how Hills Have Eyes got started? And Matt looks up for a brief moment, kind of cracks a smile, and then goes right back to puking for 20 more minutes.
Oh, man.
Awesome story. And what makes it even better is that this all capped off before 12 o'clock. Like, it wasn't even noon yet. It was like 11 o'clock, and we had already partied too hard and threw them up.
And then...
And we got back in the van and rode, like, 7 more hours to Reno.
And they all slept like babies.
I was like, I'm never going to party again. And then later that night, I think someone was like, hey, you want this joint? And I was like, fuck yeah.
Because it's been on many a tours and never broken down once. It's probably the best thing that's ever happened to Drawback is this van, which I got with my money.
Wait for it.
What did you want me to do?
Just wait for it.
Come on, ye faithful, joyful and triumphant.
We're with our friends, we're playing music. Traveled fucking halfway across our continent. What did that say? We tackled this fucking West Coast. They tried to throw it out. They're like,
You'll never afford it. We're like, fuck that, dude. We're going to San Diego and we're taking bitches with us. We're bringing it down. This fucking, no, that didn't make any sense. But fucking punk rock, man. We're taking it to the system. The system tried to bring us down and we're like, no, man, we're going on tour. I don't care. You can throw shoddy trailers at us. Fuck that. We're going to go on tour. We're going to drink. We're going to have fun. We're going to party in San Diego. Middle of December, it's snowing at home. I'm wearing shorts. You guys can do whatever you want to. I'm fucking suck.
I hate it, man. I fucking hate being a band. I hate every single person in here. I hate my band. I hate all my fucking band.
I already did. I ran in the ocean in December.
You didn't turn around. You make yourself look stupid when you...
Well, I'm not doing anything.
Well, I know.
I know.
But it's...
Why are we walking?
You think your video...
Subway's right there.
Oh, fuck. I hate
walking. You think your videotaping magic and comedy and, like, well, some real-life drawback action. But the fact is, we're,
fucking
so,
rot,
we're
yeah.
so boring in real life and on stage. It's like, why would anyone want to watch this later?
Dude, stop being depressing. It's bumming me out.
Very. I'm not happy.
Patrick's happy?
Not going anywhere.
So what's the best show that you guys have ever played?
Our first actual show in Reading, probably.
Reading was like...
We didn't know what it was going to be. We played in like this little tiny place next to
a
Planned Parenthood.
That's probably the best show ever, yeah.
That's the first time I think we felt like a fucking band that rocked.
Yeah, this, like, we played with these high school kids who... did an amazing job promoting and letting people know what was going on. We were just expecting like this tiny little show, whatever, it's first day of the tour. And like 150 or 200 kids showed up to the show. And half of them had heard our songs off of MySpace, like actually researched us before we got there. Because I remember playing, I'm looking at them like, this is our first show in Reading. And these kids fucking know our lyrics. This is blowing my mind
kids
right
were,
now.
Like, played the song, played whatever.
It was in, the venue was probably like twice, or probably like three times the size of this, but they were like, there's no stage, we were just in a corner stuffed up. It was punk rock, for sure.
Yeah, we covered like a Rancid song, the place went like nuts. And I was like, so this is what it feels like.
You walked away with like $200 or something, but it was pretty, it was probably the best show.
Every show we play in Reading's awesome. For whatever reason, we have more fans in Reading than we do in Portland.
Yeah, we've come back there and played in front of like tons of kids that just go nuts, which is awesome.
So. The song Heroes. How did that come about?
Heroes, I remember riding home on the bus from Portland State, listening, I don't remember who I was listening to, but I was thinking about, because we had just gone on tour with the Wheelchair Renegades and Rental 58, like probably 6 months prior to that.
Which was
our very first tour ever. We toured all the way through California. And I remember just thinking, like, man, I kind of want to write a song about how fun it was to be on tour and, like, all my friends and whatnot, and... At the time, we were playing a lot of shows with Goodyear, too, and then so I tried to throw, like, little hints to all the bands, mostly in the second verse, and I threw in our buddy Pat, who used to come to all the shows, who was actually at the last show, too. He partied hard. And basically, yeah, it's just a song about hanging out with your friends and whatnot. And I remember when the bass intro, when I originally wrote it, I was at the old Dude Ranch just sitting there playing by myself, playing on an acoustic guitar, and I was like, this would be a sweet guitar part. And then it was like, wasn't for like 2 months later when I wrote the song, I was kind of like, fuck that. I got selfish. I'm like, I'm keeping that for myself.
That's right.
So I when I showed him, I never even told him that I'd written it on guitar. I just played it on bass.
I think you actually did tell me.
I did?
And I think we actually decided as a group that it would sound better on bass. That was what happened.
Right, you confided in me.
I think we decided that it would sound better on bass. From like, but I mean, I could be wrong.
Man, The Woes is catchy as fuck. Got kids singing along.
I love that song because I think like in the local scene with a lot of bands, there's a lot of unspoken competition with each other, and that song was kind of like a nice wholesome shout out to like all the bands that we're just like truly inspired by from like going on tour with them, you know, which is just Rental 58 and Wheelchair Renegades and our friends Goodyear. Like those were like our solid like friends and bands that we knew of and stuff. So it was kind of cool to kind of like name drop somewhere cleverly lyrically.
And just let people know we're friends. We don't.
Yeah, just let people know that, like we're here for to have a good time.
Here's Heroes by Drawback. you gotta do is start, like, you know, before your next tour, like when you first start booking it, start emailing like Taco Bell and being like, well, you know, I bought some food and it really sucked. Because when you do that, they'll like send you like free coupons and shit.
That's true.
But keep do that to like every fast food restaurant. Be like, I went to Burger King and there was a tooth in my burger. It was horrible. And maybe like take some pictures, I mean, stage it all up.
Yeah.
And then they'll send you like a shitload of like coupons. So then by the time you get out on the road, you know, you
we
got
are doing that.
All sorts of like free Whopper coupons.
You guys haven't done this yet.
I'm about anarchy.
You're taking money from hardworking
money.
Americans that
yeah.
try to support
hard
themselves.
Hardworking Pizza Hut employees. Fuck them. I don't give a shit. I want to eat stuffed crust. I want to eat, you know, double stuffed triple crust. New York deep dish pan. Fuck it, I don't give a shit.
Hey man, I can't get there with this ketchup. I like Dr. Pepper.
Guys, come check us out. Dave. Matt.
Yeah.
Come here.
What's going on? I can't see it.
Where did you guys record your albums?
Yeah, the last two records, Addison and Bear Market, recorded with Camp David.
Yeah. We actually met with David Lindell from the Camp David Studios, and here's some of that. We can just put this in there. How do you say the experience of recording Drawback has been? Well, it was generally just a series of letdowns and disappointments, fueled by the unending feeling of despair and impotence which plagues their music. Yeah. Well, I'm not really here to critique them. I am, and obviously you think they're horrible as well. No, that's not what I'm saying. I mean, they're okay. So you remember them. I remember them vividly. It was like a train wreck. You can't forget about it. Well, what were they like? Imagine if you took a pornographic film and showed it during Sunday Mass. It's completely inappropriate, out of line, lewd, crude, and crass. Okay, thanks for your time. Well, I didn't say it went smoothly. Guys, who did the mastering on your albums?
Bear Market, Dave Lindell,
Dave,
and the mastering. And then for Addison, we sent it off to this guy in Chicago.
Carl Saff.
Carl Saff, who does a really good
job.
Did
a great job. Way to go, Carl.
If you're watching this, we love you.
Yeah, fuck yeah.
Okay, we have some footage of you guys at Camp David, creating the magic we all know. Okay, do you want to take a seat, Matthew, and stop gyrating in an erotic manner? All right, now I'll need the...
Okay.
Now
I must relinquish the seat.
My headphone volume needs to be louder.
Hi, Matt.
Dave Lindell. Now that's a name I haven't heard in a very long time. We've recorded our full-length record with him and our EP, Addison, with him. And I recorded in Ninjas with Syringes, my band that I was doing with two other friends. We recorded a full-length record. And then it went to a solo project, and I just recorded another, it's like an 8-song CD with him, just like a month ago. And Dave's a funny, hairy Jewish man, very monotone voice. He talks like this. I don't know. Dave's great. I love him. Can't complain. good guy. He used to operate out of Corvallis. He moved up to Portland now. And,
Lindell, everybody's favorite Jewish guy. He's very funny, sarcastic. He won't give you a straight answer, but the guy knows his music very well. He's a master of tone, as he likes to call himself. He can make even the crappiest bass sound delicious and entrancing. He turned me on to a bunch of bands. He's a guy that basically listens to the same kind of music as us, and it's the first time we've ever worked with somebody who listened to the ARC type of music. It's always been some 80s butt metal dude because he charges cheap rates in Portland. And yeah, working with Dave's amazing. It's just 24 hours of jokes and making fun of Zach and trying to play music well enough to get somebody to buy it.
Definitely like has his own insight about things, and he's definitely a guy that you listen to and you're like, oh, that's pretty cool. You take some of his things into consideration, you're like, oh, I might use him. He's pretty insightful and definitely full of stories.
You in my arms, all I had was your heartbeat. Hey, I lost control.
Too.
Well,
it smells like a sweaty sweaty sack in here.
Exception of the flatulence, it was all right. I ate a lot of pizza.
Hey, mention the bass tone.
And I'd mentioning the bass tone right now. That was quite thick and dense and full of fun. Who is Brie? Is it a cheese?
Brie is a special girl that we met in California. And I just named her that because it was funny, and it pissed my girlfriend off.
Fair skin.
Yeah.
Angel. 15.
Not anymore.
Now she's 18, my friends.
And the great hunt is on.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
But I remember what Travis got all this shit from his girlfriend at the time, because there's
she was so
this
mad
picture
that
of Travis, like, if you're Brie, like, it'd be like this. I'll be Brie, you be Travis.
Wait, I'm Travis? Oh, she's you're Brie?
Yeah.
Oh,
and this was, and then Travis just like.
Yeah, it popped up on the internet.
Like
and girlfriend called me while we were on tour, got really mad. So that's kind of why I named the song after her, because I thought it was kind of ironic. Or not ironic, but you know, just kind of made it for a funnier story.
That was fucking hilarious. She's like, I you tell me that you're being good on tour, and then I see this picture of you getting hugs from 15-year-olds.
I know,
she's 15.
I just bought her a present, too. We were in San Diego when I got the phone call, and
she's
I just
in
bought
full
her a present. But anyway, so
the
song's not technically about her, but I named
saying,
it after her.
Amazing.
So, Brie, if you ever watch
like
this,
a baby with a girl, like,
feel free to come back out to some drawback shows. We miss you. Say goodbye to Brie. Yes.
Bye, Brie.
Hopefully you see this. We're going to send you. We'll send you this.
That ain't creepy.
California. That is pretty creepy.
Be waiting for us.
We'll be right back.
song 911 and the insurance claim?
Oh, I have this guy. He wrote this.
Who is the liar?
Who is liar?
You well, are on a liar!
We've been trying to figure out what the song's about, too.
A lot of times when I write songs, I like to keep them pretty close to myself because a lot of times they have to do with things that I struggle with personally and with people that I know very, that I see every day. So it could be like my brother, my sister, my mom, my dad, anything. And I like to always write songs that are very broad, so it's not specific to one person, but it's specific to one situation that I have with many people, if that makes sense.
Well, no, not really.
Real Zach?
Oh, there's no necessarily person that's a liar. I did write the song because at the time when I wrote it, I had an ex-girlfriend and it felt repetitive, the relationship. And that's why I wrote like bottles black and blue. I see them just like you. I don't know. I just seemed like everything was just the same. Everything's boring, the same. Nothing's different. It was all bland. And, but I wouldn't necessarily say that she was the liar. But I would just. I would say I was the liar because I'm the one telling a lie to myself and I'm still doing the same thing over and over again and not really getting results. So.
Any special stories about that song?
Okay. It's funny on tour because like Alex and CJ from Ninjas would always come up to Zach, I think, when he was like doing anything, no matter what, and just be like, "You are a liar!" And
"Your
pants are on fire!" And I think made Zach go insane at some point. I thought he's like, "I hate these guys and I want to go home." And I hate playing music because all they do is make fun of me.
That's right. I am the center of a lot of jokes, that's for sure.
Because he doesn't fire back kids.
When we started the band, Zach was the youngest member. He's like 19.
Oh, I'm still the youngest member of the band. Yeah. I never changed.
Well, no, when we started.
Okay.
We just like gave him shit all the time because I think Zach felt like he had to measure up to Big Brother or something just because we're like older dudes that had a little bit more experience even though like we're pretty much on the same level. But I think we flipped him a lot of shit for as long as we could. To this day, even.
But, yeah, I was going to say to this day.
Yeah.
I think there might have been a lull point where it got, you know, pretty low, but then it really picked back up again, you know.
That's because we started thinking that we're really hurting your feelings all the time. We're like, Zach hates us. So we better be nice to him.
A little crazy.
This is how we show you that we care.
Yeah.
We don't know any better.
We either do this or we call you a fucking asshole. Yeah. Well, yeah. I think you like the latter.
The attention's what's good.
The attention's great.
We'll be right back.
friends there. It was my 22nd birthday. And we brought everybody. And I was drunk before we started playing. Like blackout drunk. I don't even remember really starting. It was my 22nd.
Yeah.
And to show how drunk I was so hammered. We're in the middle of our set. I looked at a couple of my buddies. I'm like, can you get me some water? And they came back with a vodka tonic. And I chugged the whole thing and set it down and said thanks and didn't realize it was alcohol. And they're all just like, oh my God. But so we're playing the set and I was like fucking drunk, messing up. Half the time I just stopped playing bass because I couldn't function. So I was like, well, I'll just sing. And I decided to take my shirt off because it's hot. And everybody starts screaming, pants, pants, pants. And I was like,
I shut off too, didn't I?
No, you didn't.
No, I stayed clothed. I remember that.
No.
You were in your underwear.
No, he took pants off. Everybody's yelling pants, and I wasn't really paying attention. So Zach takes his pants off. I had my shirt off.
I had my shirt off.
So I turned around. I was like, fuck, Zach's pants are off. Now I got to take my pants off. So I take my pants off. So I played the rest of our set in my boxer shorts. Now here's the real kicker is our buddy Heath bought me a lovely lady. To spend the night with.
Without telling me.
And so she decides she's coming up in the middle of our set. She was pretty hot.
She was a hooker?
Yeah. She's a special lady. Well, she comes up. At first she thought Zach was me.
Oh, yeah.
So she goes up to Zach and he's not wearing his pants and he's trying to play guitar and she reaches under and just cups the nuts.
She puts her hand between my legs and I'm taking 20 steps forward. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? Like,
we got this great shot of Zach kind of like trying to get out away from her hand and like her bent over like with her panties like.
Yeah, it was pretty rocking. But anyway, my ex-girlfriend at the time is standing right in the front row and watches all of this happen with Zach. And then, so the chick kind of walks out, and then she comes to me, and I'm like,
oh, I was like, that's Travis.
Well, hold on, your girlfriend at the time.
Well, yeah, she's my girlfriend at the time. She's an ex-girlfriend now. She's watching this whole thing, and then, so this girl comes up to me, and I'm almost completely naked, hammered, can barely walk, and holding my bass, and we still got like 4 songs left. And as she gets close to me, and my girlfriend was not going to have any of that. She stepped up, grabbed the bitch, and threw her to the ground. I was like, and I had no idea what was going on. I'm like, oh my God, this is awesome. The whole place just erupted. Everybody was pumped. Our buddy Pat that we talked about earlier, bear hugged Naomi, like trying to hold her back because he thought the chick was a stripper. So he wanted to see some titties.
Yeah. I was playing drums and I was like, why doesn't she come over to me? I look good, don't I? But obviously I'm not Travis.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. And then afterwards, Heath came up and he apologized. And he's like, I didn't know I was going to get you in trouble. I'm like, I don't know how you didn't think that would get me in trouble.
No, he didn't even think you had a girlfriend from what I understand. I don't think he knew you had a girlfriend. That's why he got it for you.
It's funny.
The funny thing, too, is she was offering blowjobs for $200 a pop after the show.
$200?
Fucking pricey.
Yeah. Well, she was hot, dude.
That would have been good.
That was a hot hooker. Well, I don't remember.
What did he pay for, though?
I don't know what he paid. He went home with her, so he got his youth up.
He paid for the whole 90 cent and for everyone else or something. I don't know.
Yeah, for everyone else.
He ran his dad's credit card through her ass cheek. And
it's a cheek.
Said, you're approved.
That was good. there's some good pictures on that.
Thank
you
for choosing
Drawback's
band
for watching
and listening to.
He said 2 words.
Because this
is
our
DVD.
Don't
change
your
estimate
about T
Mobile.
We
are
got me.
We
are
ready for
parties
and fun
sex
maybe
with
you
and tons
of Patrick Duffy
in TVs.
Step by step.
Patrick Duffy. Please
drink
and be
responsible.
Because
we are Drawback. Thank you and have a good day.
Night.
Thanks for watching our DVD.
Alright.
You guys.
You guys are supposed to wave. And you're making me look stupid.
Got a shot on Zach.
Yeah, you forgot your sunglasses, bro.
I didn't have the words to tell you goodbye, to tell you goodbye. Cannot believe that this is all we have left. I cannot believe you left. I cannot believe what's said. Cannot believe that all we
just...
Oh, we can hang out.
He'll never make it on Zach reality television.
Okay. So we're starting a new band.
You want to be in it?
Playing music with myself. That was your tune. I got it.
Please
take off
your
clothes,
pants
slowly
with me.
Our corporate sponsor.
Buy hams at your local, around.
Buy hams at your local alcohol retailer and you get a free Drawback Bear Market CD. Since the economy is in the toilet right now.
That's the incentive. That's the incentive to buy beer.
Yeah.
I mean, get the CD.
We're gonna drink ourselves out of this recession right now. Get your Drawback record. Bear Market.
I've got mine.
And in case you're wondering what Drawback's doing right now, we are in the process of recording our next full-length CD, which will be called self-titled, or probably just be self-titled.
Or the Black Album.
Or album referred to as Black.
We're not going to call it the Black Album, but people will be like, oh yeah, the Drawback Black Album. That's when they hit it.
Why would we do that?
Anyway,
that's a promotional tool.
Cat has gone wild.
Now we're hoping to get into the studio late August, early September of 2009. Hopefully have that CD out to you in either December or the beginning of 2010, which is when the shows will come back. Yes. We will start playing many, many shows.
Not that they're not gone, but not that we're not back.
Because
we're still playing.
We're still here.
July 18th at BC's. We're going to cure Alzheimer's.
Why would you promote that? Because by the time the DVD comes out...
I'm just winging it, dude. Don't make me look foolish on camera. So, the next show is in October.
Stop looking.
Probably the Satyricon.
Probably.
Maybe. We're probably going to open for Fishbone in November. So check that out.
Fishbone.
Then Travis says something. Not condescending.
New Drawback CD. Look out.